Hello everyone, so welcome to my playlist on functions of several variables. The agenda for today's session is we will see the notion of local maxima, local minima and saddle point. Then we will see how to find these points, that means the points where the function takes maximum minima values. Then we will see the notion of Hessian matrix and at the end we will see some examples. We will see this for 2 cross 2, 3 cross 3, 4 cross 4 up to n cross n. That means if you have a function from R2 to R, when to say whether the function has maximum, minimum or the saddle point. If you have a function from R3 to R or even R4 to R, then still this notion can be generalized to nth order. Okay, so let's go one by one. Let's first see the notion of local maxima. Suppose you have a function from a two-dimensional space to one-dimensional space and suppose you take a point say a, b. Now you can find the value of the function at a, b, so let f of a, b be that value. So this is a real number, so this is a number. Okay, now when I will say that function has local maxima at point a, b, if you are able to find a neighborhood around this point, if you are able to find some neighborhood around this point such that you take any x, y over here, you take any x, y over here and you look at its image, then its image should always be less equal f of a, b. So given a point a, b, you take, if there exists a neighborhood, if you are able to find at least one neighborhood such that you take any x, y in that neighborhood, you look at its image, that should always be less equal f of a, b. If such a thing happens for all x, y in that neighborhood, then we say that f has local maximum value at the point a, b. And what is that value? F of AB is the value. The same notion goes for local minima. Suppose if I take a point say c, d, when I will say that function has the local minimum value at c, d, so first thing is you find f of cd. F of cd is some real number over here. If the same thing, if you are able to find some neighborhood around c, d such that you take any xy in this neighborhood, you take any x, y in this neighborhood, you look at its image, this is the image of xy, then it has to be greater equal cd. So if you take any xy over here, you look at its image, if their images are greater equal the image of c, d for all x, y, then we say that function has local minimum value at c, d. And what is that minimum value? F of c, d is the minimum value. Okay, so local maxima, local minima. Okay, now let's go for the saddle point. Suppose you take an element, say alpha, beta. This is a point over here. So now when I will say that this is a saddle point for the given function, you take any neighborhood. See the difference. Here I am saying if there exists a neighborhood. Okay, you should give me at least one neighborhood such that this should hold. Here I am saying you take any neighborhood around this point. You take any neighborhood. You find f of alpha, beta. Now you take some x, y over here. For some x, y, your f of alpha, beta should be greater equal f of xy, and for some x, y, your f of alpha, beta should be less equal f of xy. Okay, so given a point, you take any neighborhood, any smaller or bigger you take any neighborhood around that point. For some points, f of alpha, beta is greater equal f of xy, and for some points in the same neighborhood, your f of alpha beta is less equal. So that means in that neighborhood, you are getting both the inequalities. If such a scenario occurs, then we say that this is a saddle point. So these are the three notions. Now, like if you recall or if you can imagine a mountain, okay, so this is mountain, smaller mountain, and here is a bigger mountain. So this top corner and this top corner will act as a maxima value. And now there was a value over here, so this will act as a minimum value, okay, or the minima of the function. If you want to imagine saddle, if you know saddle of a horse, I mean when you sit on a horse, there's a something leather seat is there, right? It is something like this and it is something like this. It is something like this so that you can keep your legs, so that your legs won't touch the horse. So it is something like this. And then to hold, when you sit, you hold it like this, right? So that surface is like this. Actually, you what to do is you go to any software, say GeoGebra or something, and you try to see what is this surface, y square minus x square. f of xy equal to y square minus x square. You will see that that saddle of a horse will come become a surface. Okay, that will come as a surface. So when you have this saddle of a horse, you look at this middle point. You look at the middle point. When you look this as a surface, this is acting as a maximum. That means greater equal. And when you are looking this as a surface, this is acting as a minimum. That means you are having less equal sign as well. So whenever you have maxima and minima for some points, then such a point is called as a saddle point. And from this is from this saddle point name has came into picture. So draw this surface and see what I'm trying to say. Or I will also post the picture at the end. So these are the three notions. Now how to find these points? Now given a function, say f of x comma y, some function is given to you. What you do is you find f with respect to x and f with respect to y. Okay, now we look for those points where the partial derivatives are zero or the partial derivatives are not defined. Then only those points, suppose you will get some points a comma b, c comma d, you will get some points where the partials are zero or not defined. Then these are the only points where you will have maxima or minima. If at some points the partials are non-zero, then at those points you will never have maxima or minima. To be precise, the theorem goes like this. So if you have a function which has a local maxima or local minima and the partial derivative exists, then at those points partials has to be zero. What will be the contrapositive? If either of the partial is non-zero, then no local maxima and no local minima. Okay, so therefore for this to exist, partial has to be zero. Okay, so this is how you find the critical points. These are called as critical points. What are critical points? The interior point of the domain where partial derivative is zero or not defined. Those are called as the critical points. So once you have the critical points, now how will you check whether it is maxima or minima? Obviously, you won't keep on doing for each and every point, right? Suppose if you get 1, 2 as a critical point, you won't take any neighborhood and you keep on checking for each and every point. There are infinitely many points. You can't keep on doing it manually. So there has to be some way, and that way is by Hessian matrix. So what you do is, okay, so let me tell you what is a Hessian matrix. Then we will take some examples. So suppose if you have a function, say f of x comma y, function in two variables. What you do is you find f double x, partial derivative of f with respect to x two times. Means you find once you find f of x, you find f xx. Okay, you find f yy, here f xx, so here f xy, here f yx, f yy. Okay, what does this mean? You differentiate your function f with respect to x two times. This means you first differentiate with respect to y, then with respect to x. First with respect to x, then with respect to y. Both times with respect to y. This is called as a Hessian matrix. This is for two, this is a 2x2 matrix. So when you have a function from R2 to R, if you have a function from R3 to R, means f of x, y, z, what will be the Hessian matrix? It will be a 3x3 matrix. So it will be f xx, f xy, f xz. Then it will become x, yx, f yy, f yz. And the last row will be f zx, f zy, f zz. If you have a function say R4 to R, then you can similarly, you can generalize the Hessian matrix. So your first row will be f xx, xy, xz, xw. And similarly one can complete. So this is how the Hessian matrix looks like. For R5 to R, it will be a 5x5 matrix. Okay, so like this one can generalize the Hessian matrix. Okay, now once you have a critical point, suppose here you got some critical points, say a comma b. Now wherever you have x and y, you replace your x and y by this ab. So now all the entries are numbers. All the entries are what? They are numbers. Okay, now here is the test. All these things are numbers. You find the first thing. This is called as delta 1, principal minor. This is the first entry is called as delta 1, principal minor. Okay, if this term is positive and delta 2, which is nothing but the determinant of 2x2 matrix, it is nothing but the determinant of this 2x2 matrix, fxx, fxy, fyx and fyy. If both the things are positive, both the principal minors are positive, then we say that function has local minima at point a comma b.
local minima at a comma b
is same as your single variable calculus. If double derivative is positive, then function has minima. Same thing. If both the things are positive, then minima. When it is maxima, if the principal minor is negative, but the second principal minor is positive. Okay, so negative positive. That means we will have local maxima. Now, if you see in both the case, second principal minor is positive. Okay, so whenever your second principal minor is negative, that means it's a saddle point. Okay, so whenever you get a critical point for a 2 cross 2 matrix, you find this Hessian matrix. Once you have this Hessian matrix, you look at the first entry and the determinant of this 2 cross 2 matrix. If both the things are positive, then local minima. Negative positive, then local maxima. If the delta 2 is negative, then saddle point. So that's the answer. So what about 3 cross 3? Suppose you have some points, say A, B, C. This is the critical point you get. For this, you do f with respect to x, f with respect to y, f with respect to z, equate it to 0, and then you get the critical point. Okay? Now, same thing. What you do, here also you have delta 1, delta 2, delta 3. Now, what is delta 1? This first entry. Delta 1 is always the first entry. What was delta 2? It was determinant of this 2 cross 2 matrix. Here, what will be delta 2? It will be determinant of this 2 cross 2 matrix. And what will be delta 3? It will be the determinant of whole 3 cross 3 matrix. First, then first 2 cross 2, then first 3 cross 3. So in this scenario, you will be having delta 1, delta 2 and delta 3. Delta 1 is the first entry, delta 2 is this first 2 cross 2 and delta 3 is first 3 cross 3. If the delta 1 is positive, the first entry is positive, the determinant of 2 cross 2 is also positive and the determinant of 3 cross 3 is also positive. When all three are positive, you will have local minima. Same thing, both of them positive, local minima. All three positive, local minima. So here also you will have local minima. For maxima, what you had? You had negative positive. So here also the same cycle works. If negative, positive, negative. So if delta 1 is negative, delta 2 is positive, delta 3 is negative, then you have local maxima. Keep on continuing the same cycle. Negative, positive, negative, you have maxima. And now in both the case, your delta 2 was positive. If delta 2 is negative, irrespective of delta 1 and delta 3, if your delta 2 is negative, then saddle point. And the same thing works here as well. So the summary goes like this. So this is the scenario. For 2 cross 2, both the principal minor positive, minima. Negative positive, maxima. Delta 2 is negative, saddle point. For 3 cross 3, if all 3 principal minors are positive, then minima. If delta 1 is negative, delta 3 is negative, but delta 2 is positive. Means what? Negative, positive, negative. In that case, maxima. And now we have both the case, delta 2 is positive. So whenever delta 2 is negative, it is saddle point. The same thing works for 4 cross 4. If all delta 1, delta 2, delta 3 and delta 4, all of them are positive, that means local minima. If negative, positive, negative, positive, the determinant, then if this is negative, this is positive, this is negative, this is positive, then maxima. And here if your delta 2 is negative, then you get the saddle point. And the same thing works on for 5 cross 5, 6 cross 6 and so on. So just keep this table in mind and everything will be clear to you. Yeah, if any one of them is 0, then you can't conclude. Then there is something called as quadratic form, eigenvalues and all those things. But I don't want to go into that detail. So if any one of the signatures are not followed, then the theorem is not true. You cannot conclude. Only if these things happens, then you can conclude. Okay, now let's jump to the examples. Now let's take an example. Suppose your f of xy is nothing but x cube, say plus 3xy plus y cube. And your job is to find the points where function is having local maxima, local minima or the saddle point. So what is the first thing you do? The first thing you do is you find partial derivative with respect to x and you find partial derivative with respect to y. So when you do that, you get 3x plus 3y square. So this is what you have. Now what is the second thing? You equate them to 0. When you equate a partial derivative equal to 0, what do you get? You get x square equal to minus y and here you get y square equal to minus x.
Now, if you put the value of y over here, what do you get? If you put the value of y over here, you get x4 equal to minus x. This implies you have x into x cube plus 1 equal to 0. So this implies your x is 0 or minus 1. Now, when your x is 0, what is your y? So when your x is 0, your y is also 0. So when my x is minus 1, this implies your y is plus minus 1. But your y can't be plus 1, right? Because if you put y equal to 1, your x square can't be negative. So don't take your x equal to 1. Don't take your y equal to 1. Your y has to be minus 1. So these are the two critical points you get. What is the next step? You find the Hessian matrix. What is the Hessian matrix? F with respect to xx. Differentiate this with respect to x again. What do you get? 6x. Differentiate this with respect to y. You get 3. Differentiate this with respect to x. You get 3. Differentiate this with respect to y. You get 6y. So this is the Hessian matrix you have. Now you put the value of this over here and apply the above criteria which we just saw. And let's see what do we get. For 0, 0, what will be the Hessian matrix? It will be 0, 3, 3, 0. You put x, y by 0, 0. And in this case, if you observe, your delta 2 is negative. 0 minus 9, which is minus 9. So since the delta 2 is negative, we have the saddle point at 0, 0. So see, that's the strong point. Here at 0, 0, no need to check for every neighborhood. Otherwise, you need to take every neighborhood, take some points, see whether it is positive, see whether it is negative. No need to do all those stuff. This simple matrix, do your job. Okay. If I go for next, minus 1, comma, minus 1. What is the Hessian matrix we get? Minus 6, 3, 3, minus 6. What is my delta 1? Delta 1 is negative. What is delta 2? Delta 2 is positive. 36 minus 10 is positive. Negative, positive. Therefore, we have local maxima at the point minus 1 comma minus 1. So that's how one can find whether at the points you are having maxima, minima or the saddle point. Now let me give you some homework questions so that you can practice. So here are the two examples. Comment the answer. Tell me the critical points and the nature, whether maxima, minima or the saddle point. So if you like the lecture, do not forget to like, share and subscribe. Thank you.